The House Armed Services Committee's version of the National Defense Authorization Act includes a new set of acquisition reforms Chairman Mac Thornberry pushed for. Some defense contractors worry that those new reforms might have unintended consequences. General Herbert Hawk Carlisle, U.S. Air Force retired, is the new president and CEO of the National Defense Industrial Association. General, thanks very much for coming on the program. What is your sense right now of the health of the relationship between the defense industrial base and the Defense Department?
Well, thanks, Francis. I appreciate the opportunity to be here. Thanks for having me. I think it's good. We can always get better. We can make things better as we move forward. The Budget Control Act was incredibly, incredibly difficult for the Department of Defense and industry. But in some ways, we learned a lot about how to get better at the way we operate together and the way we interact. So I think the relationship is good. At the end of the day, for the folks in government and the folks in industry, we're all in this together. So we're going to have to make it happen.
What is your sense of how they're talking to each other, communicating with each other both before requirements are set and after programs are in process?
I think it's open. I think we're even, you know, example is the TX program the Air Force is doing, LCS and in the Navy and Marines. I think we're much more open about talking to each other. I think we're having dialogues before RFPs go out that are more extensive, where we're asking questions, they're asking questions, we're answering. So I think the relationship and the dialogue is much better than it used to be.
I mentioned that you're new in the role as president and CEO, taking over from General McKinley. What is your personal mission as you take on this new role?
Well, it's much of what you just said. I think the opportunity to bring Congress, which is incredibly important in this dialogue, along with industry and the Department of Defense, Department of Homeland Security, the administration, together to have these dialogues, to talk about the best way forward to create the greatest national defense we can. And my job is to, as a 501c3 nonprofit, is to facilitate that discussion to promote that dialogue.
You have you mentioned the Budget Control Act a couple of moments ago, and the National Defense Authorization Act bills that came out of the HASC and SASC yesterday or early this morning, both marked well above the Budget Control Act number of $549 billion. That's a potential challenge to the members of the NDIA as they're thinking about building strategy for the future, isn't it?
Oh, yeah, it is. And I think that'll be a discussion between the administration and Congress. We'll have to see what shakes out in Congress. We'll also have to see what we can do to facilitate that dialogue as we go forward.
You were on active duty until very recently. I mentioned before we went on the air, I enjoyed watching the video of your last flight in an F-15. It was very impressive. What did you see when you were in the Air Force that industry either could help the military with more or that maybe they weren't involved with at all enough, where you would like to see more industry involvement?
So I think there's some areas that we can work together in. For one thing, I think we have the tendency in the past to issue requirements, and here's what we need. I think with industry, the Department of Defense can spend more time going, here's our gaps. Here's what we're trying to do. Here's what we want to generate and create. How can you help us? That establishes more innovation. It gets our thought processes going better. I think lowest price technically acceptable is useful in some manners, but I think it inhibits the value proposition. I think in some ways it also reduces innovation. So I really believe we can have a better discussion on what requirements / what is possible out there, where technology can take us. Things like DIUX is a great one. Other transaction agreements is another way that we can get through some of the acquisition challenges, but it's got to be that constant dialogue between industry and the government.
I've spoken with any number of your current and retired colleagues who have been leaders in the military like yourself, and I hear on an ongoing basis regarding requirements, I'd be happy with an 85-90% solution. Not everything has to be exquisite, is kind of the theme of what I hear. How do you think that gets lost in the translation?
Well, I think some of it's holding requirements steady. It's an evolving world, but you can't continually evolve in the acquisition process. So at some point you go, okay, this is what we're going to build. Mm-hmm. It ends up 85, 90%. And then you can spiral new technology, new capability on as the program goes. So build some prototypes, get some airplanes out there, get some ships out there, get some equipment for our ground combat vehicles out there. Set the requirements, hold them steady, have industry deliver on time and on schedule, which is incredibly important, and then spiral capability into them as you go.
What do you think industry needs more of from the military? Is it just certainty, which is not the military's responsibility, it's Congress's responsibility to deliver that certainty, or is there something else that the military can do more of to boost industry?
Well, I think holding requirements steady is one of them. That's one we really got to work on. I think certainty for the future is incredibly important, having budgets. There's a value to multi-year or multiple, they're looking at a block buy, I think is a term for the F-35, which will make it much more cost effective, less expensive. So I think the military's really got to work on stating the gaps, stating the requirements, getting to a solution, and then holding those requirements steady.
About 30 seconds left, General. You spoke on a number of occasions about the F-35. You're a big fan of that aircraft. What is it about it that you like? And it seems to be turning a corner. I imagine that pleases you.
Yeah, it does. It's a great airplane, and it's going to be a bedrock for the Department of Defense for the foreseeable future between all the services. And it provides that capability, the stealth technology, the avionics, the fusion. Anybody that's going to have to put themselves in harm's way, that's the airplane they want to be in.
Hawk, thanks very much for coming on the program.
It was great to be here. Thanks, Francis. I appreciate it.